Hey, I'm Grace and I am here with Grazia to give you some of my kind of top tips and background about how I built businesses online using social media. I hope I'll be able to share some of my kind of top tips, and it's such a buzzing area to be in at the moment and there is so much to leverage. So maybe hopefully this can give some inspiration to some people who might be looking for a career change or just to leverage social media a little bit more in kind of building a business, no matter how big or small. So first things first, I'm going to share a little information about my background. So I started my first business about 4 years ago now, just before I started uni. I guess technically I was selling my first product, but then that didn't really develop into what I would call a business until my first year of uni. So when I was 19, because I took a year off before uni, I worked as an intern at IBM, the tech company, in the business kind of client acquisition side. And that was just to earn a little money before uni, and also because I really wanted to get experience. I was always a big kind of stickler for the CV and really wanted to make sure that mine always looked good and that I kind of had the experience of working in an area that I wanted to work in, which I originally thought would be corporate. Then I went to uni and I had a bit of a social media following at the time, and I really needed some money, and I was kind of already selling. I'd already sold some like recipe ebooks, and then I decided to sell some more things, kind of originally digital products and then actually physical products. And it's been such a journey since then. And now I have two businesses that have done really, really amazingly well. I've been incredibly lucky, but I've also leveraged social media a lot, both with the businesses and with my personal brand. And that is something that, in my opinion, everyone should be doing right now, no matter whether it's that they want to build a big business or want to build kind of a lifestyle business that can just help them get from A to B, or they have a passion project, whatever it might be. It's something I hugely recommend, and it kind of snowballed for me. And, you know, we're really scaling these businesses now, so hoping to build them to really big, amazing kind of household name businesses. But even at the stage where it was kind of more passive income and I was just able to put out, for example, like an ebook and it just be selling and me not necessarily have to do that much extra work other than just like running the customer service and all of that, then I started looking at kind of more partners and taking things further in terms of products. I knew nothing about manufacturing and was very, very fortunate to meet some amazing people who did, who wanted to work on this with me. And I think that is one of the really big things as well, is you have to be open to taking other people on board, and not have too much ego in that way as well. I think I thought for ages that if I brought other people on board, or if I kind of hired people or outsourced, that it wasn't a legitimate business, whereas actually, like, that is the way that all businesses work, and you kind of just need to scale back your ego a bit and be able to outsource, hire people, take off some of the more menial tasks. And I probably should have hired way before I ever did, and that was one of the things that really enabled my business to grow. So sorry, I went on a bit of a tangent then, but there's so much to say. Then my second business actually was launched about a year and a few months ago now. It is a sustainable style business, so it makes sustainable clothing. So clothes, kind of active wear, accessories, all from upcycled and recycled materials. So that might be plastic bottles, factory offcuts. And that I started on working on that about a year before. And essentially it was all about, for me, because I was kind of on social media, I'd been working with a lot of brands and I loved loads of their stuff, but I essentially came to the conclusion that I couldn't promote them, because for me, I started looking a lot more at sustainability and the effects of fast fashion on the environment, and they just weren't sustainable enough for me. I kind of thought, I don't want to be promoting this kind of mass consumerism. And so I looked at more sustainable brands to work with, and then they were all kind of £100 for a pair of leggings. And I was like, well, I'm a student and fine, like I'd had businesses so I could afford that and whatever, but I couldn't recommend that to my audience and be like, oh, be sustainable, you're a bad person if you're not sustainable, but here's an £100 pair of leggings versus the kind of £35-40 one, good ones on the market. And so I looked at producing those myself, and it essentially ended up being a whole extra business, and was very much due to the gap in the market rather than setting out to start another business. But that's been a huge passion project for me. That is called Tala, and my original business is called Shreddy, which has a company called BND under it. It's all a bit complicated. So the next question is, why do you think you've been so successful? And I think this is always a slightly like hard one to answer, because you never want to be like, oh yeah, I've been really successful. But ultimately, that is something that we as women need to get a lot better at talking about. And my businesses have done amazingly, and that is thanks to a lot of people. No business, or the majority of kind of non-artisanal businesses, aren't a one-man band, and I think that's the really important thing, and that was the really important thing for me to recognize. I kind of started getting terrified the more people I was hiring, and the more I was kind of still getting all the credit for everything online, and then I was like, guys, it's obviously teams worth of people, and that's how you build a business. And I think my ego for a long time was like, no, because then it, you know, then it's not just you, and then you're getting all this praise and it's all these other people. And of course it is, that's a business and that's how you grow a business. And I think one of the most important things for me has just been knuckling down and actually thinking, what is best for the business? And as long as that is not compromising any of my kind of morals, whether that's in terms of ethical manufacturing or sustainability, then I've been all on the go ahead. And I think social media has had a huge part to play in that kind of success of the businesses. I don't think any direct-to-consumer business would be where they are now if they weren't using social media, or able to kind of operate as a D2C business at the moment if they weren't leveraging social media. And it is the most powerful tool to be using for your marketing. We didn't spend a penny of paid spend on marketing until kind of 7 months into the business. And I wouldn't necessarily say that's a good idea. That was probably a bit stingy. But it's so important to be using social media. It is a free form of media. And then obviously doing paid spend on that as well is highly recommended. For me, it was about leveraging both my personal brand, so recommending it to people who I used to recommend other products to, and kind of showing the behind the scenes of the brand, showing more of the products. But also, it's been about kind of you being able to connect with other creators and who have like similar morals and ethics in terms of the clothing and all of that they like to promote. So that has been a huge thing. And for any business I'm working on, I formulate a really, really clear social media guidelines kind of strategy. And that is something that I have always been involved with. And I think that's because I've recognized how much social media has kind of impacted the success of the businesses. And for me, that's always been about, you know, making it clear kind of what vibe we want to give off. How do people, we want to make people feel when they come to our page. For us, that's always, we want to make them feel included, no matter where they're from, no matter what they look like, no matter what size they are. So much so that it's not kind of a marketing tactic, because we're never being like, hey, like we're inclusive. We're just doing it, and we're just doing what every company should be doing. And so writing all these things down, I think, is one of the most important things you can do. And then also being able to share that with your team. So the few most important things that I kind of continuously try and do on a rolling basis is writing down renewed social media guidelines. So it might have changed a bit, the vibe you want to give off, or each collection might be slightly different. And also writing down things like the why of the brand. Like, why are you doing it? There's an amazing TED talk called Start With Why. And it's just all about, you know, in three words, what is your business for? And it can be anything, but have that behind everything you and your team do. And that has been so important for me, especially as the business has grown. And obviously I haven't been able to approve every single aspect of the business. The team has had to grow and do their things on their own accord. And things like that have helped me to be able to still communicate my vision and my message as founder of the brand to the teams. And that kind of goes through with marketing as well. For each new campaign, I usually put together at least something on the marketing of how it's going to be. And that has been able to maintain really, really strong kind of brand and made the brands influencers in their own right. My social media tips for new businesses would be both being very clear on your guidelines. So even things like, what are your primary brand colours? Are you going to use a kind of khaki, a pink and a like pale yellow as your primary colours, and then three more colours as your secondary colours? Are you going to have a font that you always use for titles? Are you going to have a font that you always use for body text? And then just making those things really clear so your feed is always cohesive. Is there a preset that you always use on Lightroom, or just a filter on Visco or Afterlight? And making that really clear so your feed is always cohesive. A nice feed is always going to get people to follow that like bit more. And so I would say that's always really important. And then other than that, I'd say gifting, reaching out to social medias, social media creators and influencers. And that doesn't necessarily have to be on a macro level. It can be on a micro level. Micro influencers have a huge influence within their bubble, and often can be more so than macro influencers, and often more trusted. So looking at kind of who your ideal customer is, find an influencer like them and gift them. Great if they can share some content just for that gifting. It might be that they need a bit more. They might need to kind of have some paid spend behind it. Talk to them, introduce them to your brand, introduce them to your story. I think as someone who's been both an influencer and a brand owner, those things are so important, because, you know, if a small sustainable company reaches out to me and they say, hey, this is our story, or they've got a charity aspect, or it's a young female founder, I am 10 times more likely to want to promote for free and never go through, you know, the kind of more brand deal side of things. So I do think that is really important as well. So essentially, for social media tips for new businesses would be, keep it consistent in terms of your branding guidelines, and then try and reach out to as many influencers as possible, not just people with big followings, but people who you see as your ideal customer. So the next question is that lots of Grazia readers have kind of expressed an interest in a bit of a change and potentially a move towards an online business during this time. And there are so many amazing benefits of having an online business. I mean, even just in the business world, the kind of fact that it is all online and you don't have the kind of retail margins to deal with, all of these things, there are so many benefits. It's also incredibly volatile. At the beginning of the coronavirus outbreak, we were down 46%, and it's a terrifying time. And I think one of the biggest things for me as a business owner is always being terrified that, you know, people's livelihoods are in my hands, and that's the stuff that gives me nightmares. I don't want to put anyone off, but it is also something that I think, because it's so ubiquitous at the moment, online businesses, it's seen as quite easy, and there are certain aspects that are 100% so much easier to build than a traditional brick and mortar business. But there are also parts of it that are harder. You know, it's a very saturated market. Almost anything that's kind of an it product on social media is also in a saturated market. So I'd say the main thing to do is start with why. Start with your concept, refine your concept, and get it really down to what you think you want to do, whether it's a passion project or whether it's just something that's a hot product right now. There's nothing wrong with that. I think it really needs to be talked about more, that there is nothing more wrong with starting a business to make money and to have as your livelihood, as long as, in my opinion, as long as you're not compromising anyone else's kind of livelihood, or it's kind of unethical, then for me there is absolutely no problem with that. And establish why. Is it why because it's a passion project, or is it why because it's an it product and you need to get that out to consumers, and that would be a great way to make some money, and then be able to springboard off that to create a bigger social media business? Is it because you love designing? Is it because you love sustainability? Is it because you see a gap in the market and it's something you want to fill? There are so many different types of online business, and I think the important thing is to identify where you want to be, why you want to do it, and then you can start doing it, because everything else falls into place. All the things like kind of fulfillment, manufacturing, all the various different things fall into place when you start thinking about why and put a purpose in place. So that for me is one of the most important things. And second from that is, as soon as you feel like you even might need to hire. It can be a fresh grad, it can be a student, it can be someone who's super experienced, it can be a business partner, but hire. I cannot express this enough. The majority of the time, as soon as you can, you should not be doing the menial tasks in business. And that is not because you know, you should always outsource the kind of boring admin work. It is because you should be working on the business, not in the business, as soon as you possibly can. So get to it and hire someone. That is always my first advice. I've kind of had a few people who've had online businesses who I've worked with before, who've asked for some kind of mentoring advice, and I just send them incessant voice notes of hire, hire, hire. If you have a bit of kind of savings that doesn't need to be going into the business, that could help you outsource or hire someone to get something off the ground, do it. And if you're an influencer, look into licensing deals, because they are an amazing way of being able to leverage your audience and not hire as many people as you potentially need to hire at this stage while still getting the expertise. So it's just a form of outsourcing, and it should absolutely be used, in my opinion, by people who can. In terms of challenges I've faced slash lessons I've learned along the way, there have been so many. I kind of feel like I'm at a point where I mean, every day is a school day, let me tell you. When I think I know something, something comes along and just tells me I don't. And that has been something that has just been important. As I've said, kind of the most important thing is have a reason behind everything, and have a concept and have your why, and then hire fast. That's one of my, I can't stress it enough. I'd say in general, challenges of having an online business too, as well as getting all the credit, you also get all the backlash. If there isn't enough stock, if there's a customer service issue, if there's a product issue, it is all down to you and it will be targeted at you. And that is not kind of a sob story, that is just the kind of fact of it. You will also get all the credit when things go right. So it's kind of something that has to be kind of taken on board. No matter how much you show the team, no matter how much you say this person's amazing, this person's amazing, you will get the credit when the brand goes right, and you will also get the backlash when the brand goes wrong. So just be prepared for that and be as honest and transparent as you can with your consumers. That is so important. The days of being a kind of stone-faced business has gone. People want to see stories, they want to see people, they want to understand that if there's a stock problem, there are also employees running around behind the scenes who've given away their whole weekend to actually rectify this problem, and everyone's on customer service, from kind of business manager to marketing manager to creatives and all of these things, and people want to see that. So share that and share your journey. I'd say it's very important. With such long days, how do you find the balance between work and rest? So my work phone was something that was really important for me, and has definitely helped me kind of switch off a bit. I'm not allowed it overnight, I'm not allowed it at the weekend, it gets locked away, and that has really changed my life. So I feel like strict boundaries, knowing when you need to sit back, knowing when you need to push forward. Sometimes productivity can be a form of self-care, and sometimes the most productive thing you can do is just sit back and have some self-care. So thank you so much for watching, and don't forget to like and subscribe to Grazia's channel. I have been Grace Beverley, and I hope you have an amazing week and end of lockdown, and good luck with your online business.